Welcome, CIA exam candidates. Everyone, I think we have people joining us from all over the world today. So welcome and thank you for joining us no matter what time it is for you. Appreciate you taking time out of your evening or your early morning, or maybe you're the middle of the afternoon like it is for us as well. My name is Melissa Leonard, and I am the CIA product manager at GLIME. I'll be the moderator for today's office hours with Joseph Mauriello. We are really excited to have everyone here today. Our goal with these webinars is to focus on a topic as it is tested on the CIA exam and walk you through common mistakes that candidates and students make so that you'll get it right on exam day. Today, we're covering a part one topic as we look at ISO 31000. So we often get feedback from candidates on this topic. So we really wanted to make sure that we covered it with this series. So again, we're really excited about today's webinar. In the GLIME study materials, this topic is covered in study unit 4. So if you're currently studying with GLIME, that's where you'll find this topic. And if you're studying with our premium review, you'll see Joseph's GLIME Instruct lectures on this topic in study unit 4. So a few housekeeping items before we dive in. I am recording today's webinar, and it will be available in our archives within two business days. I will pin in the chat a link where you can access it from the archives once it's available. You can also sign up for any future webinars that we have from that link. Right, and I'll just now introduce the man of the hour. Joseph Mauriello is a CIA, CPA, CMA, and a senior lecturer, as well as the director of the Center for Internal Auditing Excellence at the University of Texas at Dallas. The University of Texas at Dallas is an IAEP school endorsed by the IIA. Mauriello is also a member of the IIA, IMA, AICPA, and many other professional associations. He's an active, he's active in the Dallas IIA chapter and currently holds the title as past president. And as I just mentioned, he is the lead CIA GLIME Instruct professor. So you'll see him in those videos in our premium review course. So, and now I will leave you all in the very capable hands of Joseph to cover this topic.
Thank you, Melissa, for a wonderful introduction. Welcome everyone from around the world. I'm watch the chat and I see all the locations. It always amazes me how many folks dial in from across the globe. So welcome everybody. We've got a topic today that, as Melissa pointed out, is one of the topics that candidates ping us about quite a bit, the ISO 31000 risk management framework. So we'll get into a little bit of that, obviously, today. Obviously, an hour isn't always enough to dedicate to any one topic, but I think it'll get us, the big picture of where we need to be in terms of the CIA exam. So just kind of the process for the day, I'll do a brief refresher here on risk management. So certainly, if you're looking at study unit 4, hopefully those concepts will look familiar to you, or maybe it's part of your day-to-day as an internal auditor. So we'll cover some of the basics and then introduce you to ISO itself, because ISO is actually much more than the risk management framework here. And then clearly we will cover said framework. It's, again, one of those topics. It's not necessarily something you may see, particularly if you're in the U.S. We deal more with COSO, but certainly if you deal with manufacturing entities or internationally speaking, non-U.S., ISO will certainly be on your radar. So We'll cover that and go from there. Now, as we always say, right, in order to succeed on the exam, you have to be knowledgeable in these areas. Certainly risk management in general would be one of those areas. So if you haven't covered risk management, it's going to be difficult to just dive into COSO or dive into ISO, as would be the case here. So you have to be familiar with the concept, and then you have to be familiar with the individual frameworks and how they may or may not differentiate. But all of it's essentially predicated on this concept of risk management, and that concept is fairly consistent. And I think we'll see that today. So having said that, let's do pretty much what I've always done now during these webinars and come back to one of the fundamental things that you should know on the CIA exam and certainly in the profession, which is the definition of internal auditing. And again, this will be one of those times I'm just going to read it to you. Internal auditing is an independent objective assurance and consulting activity designed to add value and improve an organization's operations. It helps an organization accomplish its objectives by bringing a systematic, disciplined approach to evaluate and improve the effectiveness of risk management, control, and governance. I always tell students to kind of rearrange those last three terms, right? It's governance, risk management, and control. And that embodies, in my worldview at least, kind of what the top-down risk-based approach is all about. And as I said, we've normally associated these terms maybe with COSO, but they're universal, and you're going to see that in a little bit. So key part here, we are, as internal auditors, responsible for evaluating and improving the effectiveness of risk management. The absence of risk management by an organization, whether it's public or private, for-profit or non-for-profit, the absence of risk management would be a big absence because you could probably imagine what the internal control environment may look like and what the corporate culture would be like in the absence of solid risk management, especially in today's, in the midst of the pandemic and all the other things going on. You know, risk management is really key to driving decision making. And so clearly, in order to have better decision making, you have to have strong risk management. Notice here, performance standard 2120. It says that the internal audit activity must evaluate the effectiveness and contribute to the improvement of risk management processes. I'm going to emphasize, I didn't underline it, but the word must. This is not an option. We are supposed to do this, all right? Essentially, in the same vein that management should be undertaking risk management processes to oversee and run the entity, we as internal auditors must take a look at and evaluate those processes. Now, something that, you know, it seems basic, right? But it starts with a word here, a four-letter word, risk. And risk is not just a board game, as it turns out. By definition, according to the good folks at the IIA, risk is the possibility of an event occurring that will have an impact on the achievement of objectives. Risk is measured in terms of impact and likelihood. Now, you know, in terms of impact and likelihood, I think these are probably terms most of us are familiar with if you've been in the profession. We usually see these terms associated with some sort of risk assessment, perhaps, where we're trying to look at significance or impact, and we're trying to look at frequency or likelihood, probability. Thinking about this idea of a risk management framework with risk here, the idea is we want to be able to perhaps take advantage of risk, right? Risk could be an opportunity. We may need to mitigate risk. We may want to avoid risk. But the question comes down to how does management go about driving decisions regarding risk? And that's really where risk management frameworks and processes come in, helping in the decision-making element. So let's talk about it. What is risk management? By definition, it's a process to identify, assess, manage, and control potential events or situations to provide reasonable assurance regarding the achievement of the organization's objectives. So there's a lot going on here. As I have already pointed to, the idea here is to improve decision-making ultimately, right? Businesses, organizations have to make decisions based on their understanding of risk, and proper risk management protocols should give management and others insights into what's going on from a risk perspective. But one thing I want to point out here, and it's typically confused my students over the years, you know, they hear the term reasonable assurance, and they always associate it, rightfully so to some degree, with the internal auditor actually going out into the field and doing internal audit work, that the internal auditor provides reasonable assurance. What you should recognize here is that proper risk management protocols also provide management with reasonable assurance, right? Management's not infallible. Just like the internal auditors are not infallible. So what management seeks to do is provide itself with a method to go about making its decisions and organizing it itself as an entity. These risk management frameworks provide that guidance, that structure, if you will. And by virtue of that structure, that allows us as managers in the company, not auditors, but as management, to derive what we think is the best decision we can make given the information we have at our fingertips. In other words, it's providing reasonable assurance regarding the achievement of our organization's objectives. So, having said that, right, let's look at what risk management actually constitutes. And remember, this is not necessarily ISO that we're looking at. It's not necessarily COSO that we're looking at. This is more of the general feel for what risk management would look like. So you can see here these risk management processes. And these are straight from the GLIME material. So some of this should be familiar to you. It starts with identification of context and then works itself through risk identification, risk assessment, risk response, and then monitoring. When we talk about context, right, what that really is getting at is understanding your environment. You know, each organization, each company, if you will, is unique, right? They're not going to have the same risk profile as other companies. They may have similar risk profiles if they're within the same industry, but you can imagine, you know, comparing an apple to an orange, comparing, you know, an automobile manufacturer to a food company would probably be a very different risk profile. So whether you're management or the auditor, you have to appreciate that there's going to be different contexts. That isn't just about the industry or, you know, what makes that business tick. More specifically, it could be the business processes themselves. It could be regulations, right? Different laws, different types of technologies used in the business, market dynamics. Context is everything. We use this context from a risk management perspective to drive our risk management strategy, our approach. Now, the second thing on here is risk identification. And this is very, you know, straightforward in a sense. Look at what you know about from your past, you know, the organization's past historical performance, understand what's going on in the present, and then, you know, try to put your Nostradamus hat on, if you will, and start thinking about, well, what would be the risks coming down the road? And of course, again, we provide reasonable assurance as management here. We're not going to know every risk or maybe appreciate the extent of each risk, but we need to seek to try to identify what those risks are going to look like in the context of the business objectives we've established. Now, what's third on the list, risk assessment, i.e. risk analysis. Now, this can be done in a number of different ways. We've already seen the more common measurements of impact and likelihood. And, you know, some assessments will add a third dimension of vulnerability. We're not going to do that. But what I would point out here is it doesn't necessarily have to be quantitative or qualitative. It could be either, could even theoretically be both, but doesn't have to be formal or informal. There's no set way to do this. But what it should do is seek to take those risks identified and try to put some sort of measurement to this to appreciate the extent to which it can impact the organization. And organizations that are able to understand their business environment, the context, go about identifying their risk environment, and then assessing those risks are usually well ahead of the curve. Now, where they would need to go to, though, is the response section. So the fourth item on this list, then, how they respond to the risks that have identified, that's where the rubber kind of hits the proverbial road, right? So the responses, you know, are likely going to be on an individual risk level. As I said, you know, there's the sharing of risk, there's the acceptance of risk, the avoiding of risk, and so on. These risk responses are going to be reflective of all these elements we've looked at as far as context and identification, because obviously you're probably not going to respond to a risk that hasn't been identified, right? So this is something that's part of that process. But organizations define themselves by the nature of their risk responses. And the only way you can have stronger risk responses is if you have good risk management protocols in place to give management the opportunity to make better or more informed decisions. All right. The monitoring piece, I think that's fairly self-explanatory. Once we've identified the risks, assessed them, and responded, how are we maintaining this risk management process? Are we continuing to track these risks, see if there's changes to them over time, and certainly, you know, see if they manifest into other risks, right? So in general, that's what we mean by risk management. It's not, I personally don't think it's overly challenging conceptually. It's taking these basic principles, though, from the risk management and applying them to some of these frameworks, which we'll look at, that can maybe be confusing for some. I don't know. We'll see, though. One of the things that we need to point out, and I mentioned this kind of with the definition of internal audit, right, with the idea of governance, risk management, and control, is this idea of the top-down risk-based approach. So generally speaking, you have boards of directors, management, and the auditors, right? And when you look at this, you can see here from a board perspective, generally they provide oversight. The oversight is, you know, if you think of it in, say, a public company environment, obviously they're looking out for shareholders or owners of the firm. And they provide oversight to ensure that management is putting protocols and processes in place to execute the corporate strategy. And in doing so, they're looking out for their shareholders. This, to some extent, happens in not-for-profits as well, you know, looking out for, you know, members of organizations and the interests of relevant stakeholders. So conceptually, this top-down risk-based approach is the same throughout, regardless of organizational type. And it's also consistent conceptually with the framework we're going to look at here shortly. So this idea that the board provides oversight over management, and then the internal auditors essentially come in and evaluate risk management responsibilities to ensure that, in fact, risk management protocols are effective. So to be more specific about this, you can see here that the board determines that risk management processes are in place, adequate, and effective. That's not to say that they implement these things. What they're doing is ensuring through an oversight capability that management is taking on these responsibilities. Because if you notice here, it says management is supposed to ensure that the processes are functioning. So the board may, you know, help to provide some of this overall structural context, but it's really management that executes this, right? And then the auditors come in and examine this framework. And you can see here, this could yield, you know, specific audits, certainly from an assurance standpoint. You may run into consulting opportunities that come out of this, that would be quite common as well. But again, the idea here is that the board provides oversight, management executes the risk management protocols, internal audit evaluates those protocols, and essentially reports back to both the board and management in a sense, right? They report back to management in a sense to continue to improve risk management, and to the board to satisfy both the oversight aspect of it, as well as performance enhancement. So again, this is very similar to what we would typically see from an internal auditing standpoint, regardless if we were looking at risk management. It's the same idea when we're doing kind of your typical controls type audit. So I've mentioned COSO a few times. I think most of us are familiar with COSO. Now, one thing I do want to caution is when we say COSO, most folks actually don't think of ERM. They think of the internal control framework. All right, from 2013, which was originally incarnated in 1992. That is not what this lecture today is about. This lecture is about ISO 31000. ISO 31000 is more related to COSO's ERM framework. And COSO initially had put their framework out in 2004. It was since updated in 2017. And, you know, we're not going to go in depth into COSO ERM by any stretch today. This is not meant to be a lecture on COSO ERM. However, I want to emphasize quite clearly that you're going to see similarities. So we're going to cover some aspects of it just so it can resonate with you. But you can see here, you know, one of the key aspects is it provides a basis for coordinating and integrating an organization's risk management activities. So that coordination that we just saw between the board, management, and the internal auditors, this framework provides a way for management and the auditors and the board to essentially put all this into a package that works. And ISO 31000 does something very similar, although maybe not as direct. So for COSO ERM, at least, this is a composition of the 20 principles that span the five components within the framework. And so you can see here, thinking tone at the top, right? It starts with governance and culture. It then moves to strategy and objective setting, performance, review and revision, and then information, communication, and reporting. And as I said, we're not going to cover this severely in depth, but I thought we would be remiss if we didn't at least bring it up because you're going to see these again. These concepts to me are very similar to what you see in ISO. And I want to make sure that we're all familiar with it. So as I said, governance and culture turn, you know, that's your tone at the top, right? This idea of exercising board risk oversight. So again, the word oversight comes into play. Strategy and objective setting, right? So this is where that term context comes into play, understanding what the corporate objectives are. You know, what is it we're trying to achieve as an organization and how that drives our strategy regarding risk. When we look at performance, right, you know, it's about, yes, going through and doing the risk analysis, right, and actually identifying the risk and assessing them. But this is where those risk management activities under the management area really come into play. You know, what sorts of things are they doing to actively manage risk? The review and revision, you know, you can associate this to some extent with monitoring, where we're looking at changes in the risk environment. We're looking at, you know, how our performances to date, given what we expected in this risk environment. And then from an information standpoint, you know, I've hit upon this idea of decision making quite a bit. And to me, that's one of the things that's kind of underpinned here that's not, you know, not necessarily clear to some folks, but having this information at your fingertips and organized in a way that is digestible. And in other words, normally in the past, these things would be so disparately distributed throughout the organization that perhaps it wouldn't be easy to consolidate them into something meaningful. When you have a framework such as ISO 31000 or COSO ERM in place, it should allow you to be able to more easily digest and analyze the data. And again, reciprocate itself throughout these other four elements because it gives management better information at their fingertips to make more informed decisions regarding risk. So having said all that, let's stop talking about COSO, shall we? Let's talk about ISO. And before we get into the actual framework, I wanted to just speak for a moment on what exactly ISO is, because I don't think it's something that most of my students historically have been familiar with. You know, ISO, as you can see here, came around in 1947, so shortly after World War II, as the world economies were starting to come back, groups had gotten together and were really looking for ways in which they could standardize a lot of the product type issues, right? We were entering consumer markets at this point. Countries were coming back online with manufacturing. So it was really a way to help standardize quality to an extent. So as you can see, founded in 1947, headquartered in Geneva. It's a not-for-profit, it's a non-governmental organization. Currently it works in 165 countries worldwide. And you can see this is amazing to me, but there's over 23,000 international standards pertaining to manufacturing and technology in general. But, you know, I think if you want to put a bow on this, right, and summarize it, ISO essentially provides a platform for developing practical tools through common understanding and cooperation with all stakeholders. So they try to align multiple interests to drive this aspect of quality. And certainly, you know, when you think about their impact, it's everything from credit card usage to food safety to, you know, manufacturing standards and so on. Again, it's not a small deal by any stretch. And depending on where you are in the world, ISO is perhaps even more well-known than COSO. And certainly in various industries, ISO is preeminent. So that gives us a little bit of background on the organization itself. Some of those benefits that come out of this standardization, I've already hit upon a few of them, but you can summarize them in a number of ways. Industrial, regulatory, and society would be three ways to do it. I know from, you know, just my auditing experience, the safety piece under society, right? I used to be an auditor for a chemical manufacturing company, and I'd go globally to different plants. And I can tell you from a health and safety environmental standpoint, that was something that you wanted to be ISO certified in. So companies would go a long way in terms of trying to not only ensure that they were protecting the environment and doing what they had to do from a compliance standpoint, but obviously, we're doing so because they had agreed with these industrial standards. ISO also seeks to help to harmonize regulations where we can, right? So when you're essentially a network of 165 countries, you can, use this platform to garner that type of support, not to mention the sharing of best practices and so forth. What a lot of this does, and you can see this as the third point under industrial, is it does help to not only increase the quality, but to reduce cost. Because remember, this is, really, the genesis of this was manufacturing. So, the idea of thin margins in consumer products and obviously trying to sell more, right, in order to make significant profit, they had to find ways to embed quality while at the same time reducing cost, and this was a way to do it. So ISO has been a huge factor in getting the economies back on, back on track back in the late 40s. And certainly has manifested itself to, go beyond manufacturing today. Which brings us to the topic for today, right? Which is ISO 31000 risk management framework. Now, I will say a few things here. I just got done telling you there's 23,000 plus standards. I don't know if that means they got to 31,000 or not. So don't ask me where the number came from because I don't know. But I can tell you that ISO 31000 is essentially a risk management framework that provides guidance on how companies can integrate risk-based decision-making. So it takes a bit of a more explicit tact, if you will, compared to COSO, right? Because, you know, when I was describing COSO, I was talking about the decision-making aspect. And that's what underpins COSO, but ISO just comes right out and states it, which I think is helpful. They also go on further to define what a risk management framework constitutes. So it's a set of components that provide the foundations and organizational arrangements for designing, implementing, monitoring, reviewing, and continually improving risk management processes throughout the organization. And if you think back to what we just saw in COSO, that kind of sounds familiar, right? This idea of continuous improvement, we're trying to get a better understanding of our risk environment, right? We're going to monitor that risk environment, and then we're going to hopefully get better decision-making or responses to said risk environment. So ISO 31000 provides direction to companies on integrating these risk-based decisions. It's an open principles-based approach. We're going to look at that. And what that means ultimately is that it enables organizations to apply the principles in this standard to the organizational context, which again is like applying any other risk management framework, which is a good thing. You know, for those of you who obviously are on here because you're going to be taking the exam, right? A lot of those basic risk management concepts you're going to see repeated here. So that's another area that's consistent. The framework is theoretically applicable to all organizations and literally any type of organization. As I said, it's a principles-based approach, right? So, you know, it's not one size fits all. The idea is that you're going to take these principles and apply them to your organization how you see fit to optimize or best service your company. And in essence, that's not different than any other risk management framework. You'll see that theoretically, if you can satisfy these principles, then you have in fact formed the foundation for solid risk management. Ultimately though, you know, we talked about decision-making, but the other thing that's critical here to remember, the real goal of any risk management framework, not just ISO, is the idea of value creation and protection. Presumably, with more informed decision-making and better risk management, companies will be more successful, whether that's in pure profit terms or in some other operational efficiency, what have you, whatever your strategic goals may be. So the idea of monitoring to ensure that that value creation is then subsequently protected and then revisited over time, whether it's through audits or other quality controls in place, the idea is that we want to actively seek to continually improve. And so these risk management frameworks and ISOs in particular is really set up to do that based on whatever the unique organizational characteristics are for your firm. Now you'll see here, I mentioned before COSO's dates were, the initial framework came out in 2004, and then it was revisited in 2017. Here you can see that there was a prior version in 2009, it was revisited in 2018. I would just say to you that it's probably not an accident that it was revised in 2018 as COSO ERM was revised in 2017. But I don't believe in coincidence, so there you go. So how does ISO 31000 work? Well, we've already said it's principles-based, right? But the principles essentially drive the framework, process for risk management, and then ultimately this idea of value creation and protection. So, you know, ISO is predicated on 8 principles. Its risk management framework consists of 6 components. And then you've got this risk management process that I mentioned. So this comprehensive approach then is, again, in tandem going to lead you to sustained value. There we go. So let's talk about this principles-based approach, shall we? There are 8 principles on this slide, and we'll go through them. If you start where it says on the top and then a little to the right there, where it says integrated. What we mean by integration here is the idea that risk management is integrated into all organizational activities. So in other words, it's pervasive. If you think about the top-down risk-based approach, regardless of framework, the idea is that, you know, the board sets a tone at the top, and that culture, that risk management ideal is embodied through everything we do in the organization. And then management takes that and runs with it in setting up the risk management activities and actually executing and ensuring that those function. The auditors come in, and essentially the internal auditors will evaluate quality of the risk management framework based off of the guidance that the board has given to management and whether management is meeting these expectations. But this is really predicated then on this idea of it being integrated, that it's part of everything that we do as an organization. Beyond that principle, if we go to structured and comprehensive, here what we're saying is you actually need to define what it is you're doing, right? So we can't just have, you know, ill-defined or undefined roles and responsibilities with regards to risk management activities. There needs to be a formal structure in place detailing whose responsibility it is to take these roles on. As we saw in that prior slide, obviously we gave some definition to what we think the board should do, what we think the internal auditor should do, what we think management should do. But it needs to be much more comprehensive than that. We need to have specific roles spelled out within that management structure. And then from there, we can start doing more things similar to the customization, if you will, with regards to some of the more unique aspects of our organization. So let's talk about customization. Because not every organization is the same, right? Each organization is its own unique snowflake. You should take it upon yourself from a management perspective, that is, to customize it to meet the needs of the company. And, you know, that might be, you know, something that, you know, it looks very different from competitors within your industry. Certainly, you know, alternative industries, if you will, look very different. The customization, though, the key thing here is it still needs to mirror the overall principles of the framework overall, right? So you can't just customize it to avoid actually having to implement good risk management. That's not the idea here. But assuming we're doing this for the right reasons, customization should yield results that are tailored to your organization. Inclusivity, if we look at what constitutes inclusive from a principal standpoint, it's the idea that we've got the involvement of stakeholders across the spectrum in terms of enabling what we would call informed risk management, which is just convoluted shorthand for, hey, we want to empower our people to make good decisions based off of the risks that we are aware of. So if we include folks in this discussion at various levels, various stakeholders within the organization, they will be better informed about our corporate strategy, our risks associated with the strategy, i.e. our threats, and how to respond to them. Anecdotally, I've seen articles in the past where, companies that do a better job within capital budgeting and within risk management overall, where they get folks involved through risk assessment and other activities, it generates a better appreciation for the what the organization is trying to accomplish. And it's not just a situation where you have that, problem of messaging, right, where the board and senior management have an expectation for the firm, but it's never communicated to everybody else. The more stakeholders you get involved, that message becomes much more pervasive and it's understood. So you've got better integration, you've got better comprehensive understanding of roles and responsibilities through this idea of inclusion. Something else that's important, right, and certainly a reflection of the times we live in, is this idea of dynamism. So the risk management framework from a principal standpoint should be dynamic. The idea here that risk is not static, it's going to change. As we say here in the US, it changes on a dime. And the framework should be robust enough that it can handle these changes. And in other words, it can put management and these stakeholders in a position to act upon changing risk within a framework that allows it to be evaluated appropriately. To that point, in order to react to risk that changes, you have to have good available information. So again, it comes down to some sort of decision-making capability. Risk management should consider past, present, and future understandings, right? So that historical information, what's going on in the present, what we foresee going forward, all those things should be taken into account. It seems so elementary at some level that we should be thinking about what the impacts of our decisions are going to be. But as you've probably experienced at some point in your life, whether in corporate or in your personal life, you know, sometimes you make a split second decision. You don't necessarily think about what the impact was. Maybe you don't appreciate the history of what led up to that decision. But certainly in a corporate environment, you want to establish a framework that allows that call it 360 degree view, because that will hopefully lead you to optimizing your decisions. The seventh item on here is the human and cultural factors. You know, obviously this goes beyond corporate culture, right? I mean, you think, you know, there are organizations that work in a specific city. There are other organizations that are multinational, global. You know, the human and cultural aspect is real, and we have to incorporate that into our considerations. And, you know, I had a student, I guess it was last year or so, asked me, well, you know, in the age of robotics, aren't we going to, you know, not worry as much about human and cultural factors? And I argue it's going to be the opposite. I think we're going to actually have greater impacts here. But we need to appreciate not only the stakeholders in terms of our employees, shareholders, and so forth, but certainly the customer dynamic and just, you know, the outward facing roles of our organization. You know, how do we interact? And, you know, what risk does that pose and what opportunity does that pose? So we do need to consider that. Last but not least is continual improvement. Again, that's a theme that we're going to see regardless if it's ISO or COSO. So I don't want to belabor that point, but the idea that we will seek to constantly learn or continuously learn from our experiences and then seek to better the outcomes over time. I think that's, you know, a kind of a reasonable approach, and ISO certainly embodies that. Now, we go from the principles to the framework, and here are the six components of the framework. You'll see it's integration, design, implementation, evaluation, and improvement. And of course, it's all centered on leadership and commitment, which I would advise you is not an accident, right? So as we talked about with the top-down risk-based approach, the idea of the board driving oversight, senior management driving execution, they are at the center of this initially, right, with leadership and the commitment to these principles that we've discussed. So they demonstrate this in terms of implementing the framework's components, as we've spoken of, adopting policies towards risk and so forth. Their actions speak, frankly, louder than their words. The integration component here, if we start there, then takes into account, much like we were saying with the pervasiveness throughout the organization, it tries to take all the facets that we've discussed in terms of identifying objectives, corporate structure, the governance, culture, realizing that, you know, we're going to embody all this. It can be dynamic, but we have to ingrain risk management into all of these areas. It has to be, you know, risk management has to be an understanding that is pervasive throughout the organization. So that's where the integration piece comes in. The design piece is, again, understanding context, understanding organizational structure, and actually how we go about articulating our commitment to risk management. How do we build it into our control environment? How do we build it into our people, our processes, and our technology? From an implementation standpoint, you know, do we have a plan in place for risk management? Do we have decision-making protocols? You know, how do we engage with our stakeholders towards these types of arrangements, right? So the implementation piece, it's fairly straightforward in that sense, because if you don't implement the risk management principles that we saw in the prior slide within your framework, you're probably not going to have a successful framework. The evaluation piece, don't get confused on this. This is from a management perspective, right? How does management know that its framework has, and its efforts have been successful, right? There should be some sort of performance measurement system in there to look at performance against expectations. By that same token, when the internal auditors come to evaluate risk management processes, this could very well be one of the places they start, right? Did management achieve its goals? You know, the board in its oversight role has an interest in this. The internal auditors have an interest in this because they're evaluating the performance of risk management. But from a management perspective, they are going to do self-evaluation, and then they're going to have the internal auditors come in as well. And then again, from improvement, it's just like before, this idea of monitor, right? The idea that we have built-in processes, if you will, sub-processes to not only evaluate organizational performance, but to constantly evaluate how we might be able to do something better. And certainly the internal auditors could also contribute to this, but management should be taking it upon themselves to actively think about this, all right? When we look at the elements of the risk management process, and you know, this is, you know, another one of those images you've probably seen in the text here. And, you know, you might be thinking to yourself, well, you know, it just seems like there's so many frameworks and there's so many principles and processes. Keep in mind, a lot of this is interrelated. What this slide is really telling us here, as far as these depictions, are how we take that context we spoke of earlier and establish scope and criteria for how we go about evaluating risk and managing. All right. And you'll see here that the communication and consultation piece coupled with monitoring and review contribute to this. And so the elements of the risk management process really don't look any different than what we saw earlier. The idea of, hey, we're going to do risk identification. We're going to define the scope, which is probably entity-wide. We're going to look at external potential impacts, internal impacts, and so on, market dynamics. We'll set that criteria, whatever that criteria may be. We'll conduct our risk assessment. We're still going to look at impact and likelihood. We'll create that inventory of risks through the risk identification and analysis process. And once we've arrived at our evaluation, guess what? We're going to formulate responses, i.e. the treatment. And so you can see that that area then culminates in this idea of recording and reporting. And then we have consistent and continuous monitoring and review of these risks. And this idea of integration, we have communication and consultation where this is being communicated to impact better decision-making throughout the organization. So, you know, this is not to, you know, undermine the other slides, but this is particularly important. And this is where, in my view at least, you know, it shares a lot of the DNA in particular with COSO. You know, the idea, particularly in the risk treatment area, right? The idea that we can accept or avoid or reduce, share or pursue risk. These are terms you're most likely already familiar with, given your understanding of COSO, given your understanding of not just risk management, but the internal control frameworks as well. It's very similar. So similar, in fact, that I could almost have repeated a slide from earlier. This idea of, hey, this embodies the top-down risk-based approach from the board overseeing the efforts of management, which then is essentially looked upon in terms of an evaluation by internal audit, who of course then reports back to the board. So again, the board is concerned with oversight, ensuring that management has effectively established risk management protocols to tie to the expectations, the strategic objectives of the organization. For management, they're adopting a risk attitude. And let's not be coy about this. The reality is it's going to mirror the tone at the top as warranted to some extent by the board, right? But that risk attitude then drives corporate culture. It drives how risk management is established or implemented within the organization. And it informs our understanding of the identification and analysis of risk. That understanding then determines the control environment. How does management manage these risks? Through their internal controls. And then guess what? Internal audit through its assurance activities can audit the controls themselves, but more importantly in this context, can look at risk management as a whole, right? Whether we want to call it enterprise risk management or ISO 31000, internal audit's responsibility then is to ensure that the board has these processes at their fingertips as affected by management. All right, let's get beyond just, you know, what we would look at from a corporate management standpoint, but let's talk about what it looked like from an internal audit standpoint. In terms of the assurance approaches, you've probably seen in the book these discussions on key principles, process elements, and the maturity model. And we're going to spend a little bit of time here on the maturity model, but I do want to talk about the first two areas. There's really no shortage of ways you can audit an ISO 31000 environment. And the approach is no different than a COSO ERM environment, I might add. You could take the principles-based approach, right? If you think back to the slide we had earlier where we mapped out the components of the COSO ERM framework, you could audit a control environment based upon those principles, just like you could do that within ISO 31000. You could do the risk management process itself, the elements of that process, and say, okay, are these risk management elements in place? What I would argue is looking at the principles is going to be very tedious and granular in a sense. It's more work. The process element might be more manageable. The reason the maturity model exists is because it kind of incorporates all of this while getting the most bang for your buck. All right. It should take fewer resources to execute an audit based off of the maturity model. So let's talk about this maturity model. You can see here, right on the slide, it says, based on the principle that effective risk management processes develop and improve with time as value is added at each phase in the maturation process. maturation is a word you'll want to pay attention to, right? That should trigger the thought of, okay, things can improve over time. We know that the goals of risk management, regardless of COSO or ISO, is to continuously improve, or improve rather. So the maturity model approach at the end of the day allows you to essentially benchmark where you think your organization exists within the model, and can give you and your organization management insights into areas to beef up or to manage differently in order to reach whatever your risk management objectives may be. Ultimately, it's about looking at whether management's risk management framework is progressing as intended, that it adds value, and that it essentially meets the organization's needs. Because we know that you don't necessarily have a universal structure that every company is going to put in place and say, well, this is how we do it. We're taking a principles-based approach through these frameworks, which allows organizations variability in how they implement these processes. So if we look at the frameworks, maturity models specifically, and we'll start with what the book calls CMM, or Capability Maturity Model, you can see here that less mature organizations are going to possibly be in that initial bucket, right? Level one, whereas those who feel like they've optimized their space are going to be in level five. In my experience, companies don't like to classify themselves in either of those buckets. They prefer to land somewhere in the middle. Just because a firm doesn't feel like it can classify itself as a level five just because it's not perfect, keep in mind, management is seeking to provide reasonable assurance about its risk management framework in the same vein that we are expressing reasonable assurance about whatever the audit is at hand. Just because something is in the level five optimizing category doesn't mean that it's perfect, okay? What it does mean, though, is that the environment is mature enough that there's not only a sense of monitoring, but built-in continuous improvement so that the organization will continuously ensure that the risk management framework is effective and efficient. And that's where this idea of optimization comes in. Quite often in less mature organizations, it's very difficult to beef up your structure enough to get past, say, defined or managed states. It's one thing to have a strong board, good oversight, policies and procedures in place, but maybe they don't have enterprise risk management built out yet, or they don't have other capabilities like a dedicated ISO team built into it, whereby they can actually exercise some utility from these standards. So wherever the organization falls within this maturity model, it's not necessarily right or wrong. It's more of, hey, this is our progress report to date. And quite often this will be the audit model of preference because it allows the organization the ability to take credit for the things they've achieved while at the same time pointing out areas to, again, continuously improve, which, again, is what we're shooting for. Now, there's a second model that is similar. Capability maturity model integration. And so this is version 2.0, and you can see they've changed some of the nomenclature a little bit. We have incomplete at level zero. We still have five at optimizing, but the key change that I would point to here is this idea of quantitative management. Certainly in the age of data analytics, in the era that we live in today, that's something that adds quite a bit to this. It quantifies performance improvement goals to meet stakeholder needs. Organizations have been doing this for some time. Just remember, the audit approach is similar. You're going to evaluate and figure out where the organization lies within the maturity model based on the risk management framework that's been established. How are you going to do that? I mentioned performance measurement earlier. The organization should have performance measurement standards in place. This is a critical aspect because if we don't have performance standards, right, and we don't understand what it is we're trying to achieve, we can't measure success. And quite often when we look at the maturity model, what we find is organizations may be doing a lot of good things, but they actually struggle with their ability to record the successes, right? And be able to take the credit for this. So whether it's included in terms of dashboard reporting or some sort of other metric, making sure that a performance measurement system in place is a critical element. Now, having said all this, we've talked about COSO today, we've talked about ISO. here's something that I think folks just don't think about actively, and that is the similarities between the two. In both cases, it's a top-down risk-based approach predicated on principles with the idea of driving value to stakeholders, right? Enhanced decision-making, performance enhancement, and ultimately the protection and or development of value, right? So they really are two peas in the same pod to a large extent. And many organizations I've seen actually will try to do both, right? Formally, they may be a COSO shop, but maybe they're in the manufacturing industry. They'll adopt it and try to map out both together. I don't believe I have a slide in this deck that shows this, but in the past, in my classes, I have essentially tried to map out the COSO elements and components to the ISO principles and elements. And it's not a difficult exercise. And in fact, can actually yield quite a bit of insight. So both are quite comparable. They're both doing the same thing, albeit they're coming at it from perhaps a bit of a different way. All right. So, you know, if I were to summarize the ISO 31000 framework for you, similar to COSO, it generally aligns with ERM from the COSO perspective. It's a holistic view of risk management, and it's principles-based, which again, aligns with COSO. So it doesn't get much more straightforward than that. So let's see what we've got next. I think we're moving on to our first MCQ of the day. So Melissa, I'm assuming you're probably gonna put up the survey for the question. So we don't want folks answering the question, of course, in the chat. But while we're getting that set up, I'll go ahead and read the question and the answer choices. So the question says, which of the following approaches to providing assurance on the risk management process is based on the principle that effective risk management processes develop as value is added at each stage of maturation? Answer choice A says the process element approach, B, the key principles approach, C, the maturity model approach, and D, the risky business approach. We'll give folks a few seconds to manage their risk. Melissa, it looks like the responses are coming in.
They're coming in. I'll give everyone just a few more seconds to make an answer selection because, like on the exam, you don't want to leave an answer or a question blank. So to make sure you select something, please make sure to select it on the screen, your answer choice, and then click submit to give everyone an opportunity to answer on their own.
Yeah, and definitely answer on your own. Don't just assume that the folks in the chat know what they're talking about. Don't know what they're talking about.
If you don't see a submit button, possibly scroll a little bit after you make your selection. I had to scroll. So, all right. So we have a good number of already submitted. So I'm going to go ahead and end the voting now. We'll share those results here. Okay. So it looks like majority of people, 56%, selected C, the maturity model approach.
All right.
Yep. Shortly behind, well, kind of far behind that, but second is B, the key principles approach, with 8%.
How many people picked the risky business approach?
1%.
Oh, thank you. At least they have a sense of humor, I suppose. Well, let's go ahead and put the question back up on the screen. And while answer choice C, of course, is the correct answer. And, you know, the giveaway on this is, you know, the end of the question stem literally uses the term maturation, right? So it just, you know, answer choice C where it says the maturity model, that should, you know, trigger a response immediately. When we're looking at the process element and the key principles approaches, you know, these are, these are ways in which you can go about auditing or providing assurance in these areas, but they're not going to tell you from a benchmarking perspective where you would be relative to other organizations. That's the only one that does that is the maturity model. The Risky Business approach, by the way, is a movie. Risky Business is a movie from 1983, so I seriously doubt it had any relevance here. But, you know, Google Tom Cruise and find it on your own. In the interest of time and not so risky business, let's go to the next question, though.
All right, I'll pull that up.
I'll go ahead and read this while we're pulling it up on the screen for selections. It says, under the ISO 31000 model, the risk assessment element of a risk management process, A, defines the scope of the risk management process and risk criteria. B, compares the established risk criteria with the results of the risk analysis. C, determines whether residual risk is within the organization's risk appetite. D, includes risk identification, risk analysis, and risk treatment. So it's a mouthful. So take a look. Think about it.
And again, I'm going to give everyone about 60 seconds to make their selection. And, you know, if you're unsure, you know, one of the things we'll tell candidates, if and do this with the poll as well. So if you're unsure of your answer or what the correct one is, you can probably eliminate one. Fortunately, there's not something like risky business, but you can usually at least eliminate one and narrow it down and then make a choice from there. Because on the exam, you get points for getting the question correct. You don't get points taken away if you miss a question. But if you don't answer it, you don't get an opportunity for points. It's just a missed opportunity for points.
Yeah, you miss all the shots you don't take.
Exactly.
Yep.
So, all right. So I'm going to give everyone about 15 more seconds so that way they don't miss their shot and they can. All right. Right. So, and it looks like in the chat, people were putting some, but there are very mixed results here. So,
yeah, this one's a little trickier. I don't think it's clear cut as our last one.
All right. So, looks like the majority with 38% selected D, includes risk identification, risk analysis, and risk treatment.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, the answer, the actual answer is B. How many folks picked B?
13%.
Wow.
So we'll go back to that question in the slides there.
Yeah.
But that was second. That was the second choice.
It was second. Okay. Yeah. And how many people picked risky? Never mind. this one's a little tricky because you're probably, I can almost tell you, everyone on here is thinking, I saw that slide with the circle and all those things in it, and that constitutes answer choice D. But the answer choice that you should have been looking for here is actually B. And part of this has to do with, well, a couple things, really. Risk assessment, by definition for ISO, is the process of identifying, analyzing, and evaluating risk, all right? But the risk treatment is equivalent to risk response on COSO. It's not part of risk assessment, per se. Risk treatment follows risk assessment, so it can't be D, all right? It's not going to be A, which defines the scope of the risk management process and criteria. That's separate. The risk assessment in ISO, and for that matter in COSO, is a very specific area. We're looking at impact and likelihood more generally. So the choice that best replicates this is B, where we're saying, hey, we have established risk criteria within the organization relative to our performance objectives, and we're going to look at the results of our analysis. Think very granular in terms of the steps within these models. And that would help you here. But remember that risk treatment is not risk assessment. So even though that circle that we saw, that depiction mirrors the process, if you will, it doesn't necessarily mirror the individual steps. The individual steps are individual. So B is the answer there. I will tell you that that's a tricky one. But let's go to the next one. We'll see if this one's tricky. This will probably be our last one. And I'll go ahead and start reading it. According to the ISO 31000 risk management framework, the board is responsible for A, providing assurance regarding the risk management system, B, identifying and managing risks, C, overseeing risk management, D, setting the organization's risk attitude. So let's see how we do on this one.
Remember, try not to put the answer in the chat and select it on the screen so we can see all your results and give everyone an opportunity to answer kind of like on their own without being influenced by other.
And I don't want to keep seeing people put answer choice E in the chat. let's not confuse anybody.
And because of time, we are running a little short on time. I'm only going to give everyone about another 10 to 15 seconds to make their answer choice here.
Yeah, I think folks are going to get this one. I do.
Okay. We had a couple F's and E's. All right. I'm going to go ahead and end the voting now. We'll share those results. And it looks like 50% majority, like this was the one that they chose the most, is C, overseeing risk management, and then followed closely by D at 23%.
Good. So, I'll keep this short and sweet, but remember, think back to what I said earlier. Regardless of the type of framework, it's the top-down risk-based approach. And in a top-down risk-based approach, the board provides oversight. And the word is right there, overseeing risk management. Answer choice C is the correct answer. The auditors provide assurance. The actual management of the risks is done by management. And management actually can take on and should be taking on the role of the risk attitude with guidance from the board. But it's answer choice C, the oversight role. So answer C is correct. Real quick here, as we close things out today, obviously, being generally familiar with the concept of risk management, even if you don't specifically remember the tenets of ISO or the tenets of COSA, that's going to drive your success because those concepts are going to be similar across all the risk management frameworks. Be familiar with the frameworks and some of the nomenclature. I see in the chat, some people are saying, well, is risk attitude, risk appetite, and so on. There's going to be some nuance, but generally speaking, when you see these questions on the CIA exam, I would say 75 to 90% of them can be answered just by being familiar with how risk management is undertaken. So with that, I appreciate everyone watching today.
Yes, thank you, everyone. They're on the screen for a few seconds. There'll be contact information if you have any questions. Also, watch out. We will have our next episode, September 24th. We're going to be moving to Friday for that one. But we'll cover a part two topic, variable sampling, on that one. So hopefully we'll see everyone there in a few weeks. And I'm glad everyone was enjoying today's presentation. So thanks, Joseph. That was great.
Thank you, Melissa. Take care, everybody.